Well, welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of teaching and vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland. I am your co-host, Tommy Kreitz, and we're going to have a conversation with someone today because we believe everyone has a story. But before we get into that conversation, we are going to have a conversation amongst ourselves about whatever it is
about
that we want.
That we're experts in.
Like
politics.
That we possibly couldn't contain any more knowledge in our brains about.
So we're recording this on Wednesday, mm-hmm. the September 11th. So sad day in the history of our fair nation. Mm-hmm. 23rd anniversary of the Twin Towers coming down, which is always sad. But also, day after the proverbial twin towers of our electoral system went head to head and tried to bash each other to death in the ring of whatever.
Can I tell you something?
There was
funny?
A whole image that I was going to draw out there that I thought would be really, really sharp, but then I gave up on it because I started thinking to myself, you know what? Whatever.
That is. I talked to someone yesterday. It was really funny. I was at the gym actually, and they're like, I'm going to go home. I'm going to watch the debate.
Like it's a sporting event.
Yeah. We're going to make some popcorn.
Don't call me. I'm going to be watching the debate. Yeah,
we're making a night of it, you know?
Like chips and
I thought that
give me another beer, honey.
Yeah. It's like, honestly, like things that I've never thought in my life. I actually didn't even know it was happening until that moment.
Oh yeah. No, I got home last night and I realized after I'd got home that it was the night that they had the debate.
Did you watch it?
No, of course not.
Did you get any spark notes on it?
I don't watch. I did. I mean, I read a little bit about it, but here's the thing. Can we just say, isn't it weird? Okay. Little history.
Yeah.
I think it was 1960. Okay. So long time ago, buddy.
Long time ago.
We're talking about 60 years ago. Okay. Yeah. In 1960, John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon had a debate. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It was the first televised debate, but it was broadcast at the same time on radio and then on TV.
Yeah.
And this is very famous because it's a very famous moment in what we call media ecology. Media ecology is the study of how media or a medium, like what we're using right now, with podcasts, or how television or how the internet or Twitter or whatever, how the message itself is changed by the method that you use to communicate it.
Sure.
Okay?
Yep.
So, for example, me talking to you face to face, that's changed. The interaction has changed if I write it down and I send it to you in an email.
Yeah. Imagine if we emailed this podcast.
Yeah. I mean, it's already bad.
Yeah.
Could you imagine?
Yeah. No.
But the email, you can't tell people's facial features. You can't tell. There's a lot of communication that doesn't happen if you can't see each other.
For sure.
Anyway, that's what media ecology is about. So one of the key moments in the history of media ecology was when this new medium, television, came on the scene, and it drastically changed the way that people understood who was going to be president of the United States.
Right.
Because Nixon, according to everybody on the radio, he won. Like, hands down, he won. Mm-hmm. But everybody who watched it on TV thought John F. Kennedy won.
Yeah.
And it's because Nixon decided not to use any makeup.
Yeah.
And so he was, he looked awful. Yeah. You can even today go back, it's black and white. So you go back and you can watch some of the thing and he is so washed out. I mean, he looks pale as anything, but Kennedy looks like he's alive. So everyone's like, well, I don't want a dead president.
Yeah, I want that alive guy.
We want Kennedy. And this was the beginning, quite honestly, probably the beginning of what has now culminated in all they ever talk about now is zingers. They just want to land. Talk about stuff like, did they land a blow? And by blow, it's not like, hey, did they win a debate over a policy discussion?
Yeah, right.
Or even talk about the values of each party. It's, did they land some sort of like little zinger, like, you're no Ted Kennedy, you know, like, or whatever it is. You land these little quips, which is what's now the soundbite has become the thing. And, you know, who wins the debate is now which person has the fewest memes made of them.
Sure.
And so you don't really know who won.
Or the most positive memes about
you. Yeah, so if it's a positive meme, then you can do it. So there'll be, you have to wait almost days. And it doesn't matter what the people say. And what's so crazy now is that we have politicians who are winning political seats who have no discernible skills. They have no... You know, and I apply that across the board from one party to another.
Yeah, right.
They're not people who like you would come up to and say, "Now this person's really brilliant. They're able to, you know, master the economics or whatever." They're just like, it's not a surprise Donald Trump was on TV.
Yeah.
Like that was that's how he became Donald Trump, was The Apprentice.
Yeah.
I mean, he was big deal before that in business and stuff, but the reason that people knew him was is because he was on The Apprentice. And he understands the way you're fired. but he understands the way that all of it works.
Yeah.
And Kamala Harris, it's weird because they're actually running a campaign where they're almost trying to avoid any kind of communication of anything substantive.
Isn't it wild? Like,
it's amazing.
Isn't it wild?
But it's all because of the same issue.
Yeah.
Right?
It was wild that like we are like, you know what? We should have the people who make our policy and govern us. Those, we should elect them based purely on like if they can dunk on the other person.
Yeah, I know.
It's just such a wild thought.
Like, which one of them?
Yeah. Which one of them can like,
it can be the quickest on their feet.
Yeah. And give the biggest diss.
Yeah.
Like mud raking is the currency of politics right now.
Yeah. As if that's like a great skill.
As if that matters in the least for someone who's doing policy.
I know. And the
politics.
People who have the ability to be quick on their feet and give those kinds of zingers are often being encouraged to go into politics. Well, that person should go into politics.
Yeah. It's usually like, not a helpful thing in writing policy either.
Person must be a horrible person, but they're really quick on their feet and they're able to, you know, just...
And they look like Kennedy.
Zing somebody. Yeah. It's amazing. It is.
Oh, man. I don't even... I will be very interested to see I haven't heard anything about the debate yet.
Yeah.
Which is shocking. Which, does that mean it was just not a good... It was very lame.
Don't you ever think that in the debates, the people who go in, it's kind of like apologetics ministries.
Yeah.
The people who go in believing are like, yeah, these are great reasons to believe in the faith. And the people who go in not believing are like, these are, think these are so, they're not compelling at all.
Yeah.
So that's what I find. How many people are genuinely sitting on the fence, sitting there on their couch going, man, I don't know. I don't know which one of these people I want to elect. Like, unless you're in, I don't know. I guess I remember watching a debate in New Zealand once, and I didn't know any of the people. And I came to the conclusion that I am probably the only person around who genuinely is entering this debate thinking, yeah, I'm here to find out who's got the best arguments for whatever, or who's got the best presentation or whatever.
Yeah.
But everybody who I watched it with was like, "Why, I hate that guy." And I was like, "Well, actually, he made some good points."
Yeah.
What are you talking about? How could you possibly?
I would actually, weirdly enough, as I'm all for, you know, the banter. But I would actually really appreciate more formal debates of substance and not, you know, having actual like strict time rules.
Yeah, dude, you're gonna do like a Lincoln Douglas debate.
Yeah,
like where like they
actual
have
debate,
legit debates,
rebuttal.
Yes,
like stages of, so that you can actually hear the ideas without being, you know,
right.
Without the,
well, and one of the things they do too is that they try to, so when they're dealing with another issue, they go back to the old issue.
Yeah.
Like there's a few things I didn't get a chance to say.
Yeah,
after
which
that
is like in a debate format. That's off limits.
That's
you
right.
can't do that.
I found that I was lost horribly in the last little round. Yeah.
When like you said that thing, I realized that I'm in trouble. So no backtracking. Like in a formal debate, you can't do that. No. You have to move forward. You have to.
No. And it's hard because they do. Yeah. The moderators are always weird with their questions and stuff. It's very challenging. Mm-hmm. But here we are.
Yeah.
We got to live with it.
I feel like we learned some things. I learned some things today.
Did you?
So when we were saying before in the podcast that we are experts, you might have thought, surely they're joking. Nope.
We are.
Actual expertise.
We've given nobody any hope for anything.
Yeah, media like, ecology. Nah, so you learned something new today, hopefully,
it's
maybe.
Time. No, it's not. Vote for who you like, yep. And we'll see where it ends up. Vote for who you like, and Jesus will be win.
Yeah, Jesus is king.
Which is weird, I know, because some people will be like, well, how could Jesus win if the person who gets in doesn't reflect his values? And I would say because he ultimately is, God is sovereign over all these things, and even the strategies of the enemy will ultimately serve his purposes. So,
do you think that, is there any bad kings over Israel?
Oh, a lot of them. A lot of bad kings over Israel. Yet. And yet the Lord continued on. So we at least have that. It's a little easier for me. I'm going to be honest with you. It's a little easier for me.
As
a
Canadian?
I feel like I've come in from the outside of the U.S. Yeah. over the last 20-something years.
Well, you guys have an interesting one up there, too.
And I have lived in New Zealand, and I have lived in Canada. And every person who was the prime minister of both of those countries and all the time that I was there, both places, 20-something years, was far worse politically than I would have liked.
So you're saying Justin Trudeau?
Well, yeah, I mean, but just far, people in the States would freak out if those particular people were president of the U.S. So when people start saying stuff like, the world's going to end if so-and-so gets in, whether in this case it's Trump or Kamala Harris, I always kind of falls a little bit on deaf ears for me because I'm like, look, I get it. It's your taxes might be higher at some point, which is awful. And there might be policies that kill the unborn more, which is awful. And there are all sorts of important issues that you should make your decision on. And yet at the same time, life does go on to some degree, and you're able to, you know, you're still going to be caring about the same things you cared about before, your family, your kids, your work, your all those sorts of things. So I don't know. It gets really old for everybody constantly saying, this is the worst, this is the last such and such of our lifetime. Yeah. And like the most important, every year it's the most important election ever, which I don't know, maybe it is. One of them's got to be the most important. So
one
I guess
of them.
Maybe it is. But after a while, when the little girl keeps crying wolf, you're like, maybe it's not a wolf.
It's like those people who are trying to always predict when the end of the world is.
Yeah.
For sure, it's 2012.
But I got it wrong. Oh, didn't carry the one.
My numerology was bad. Wow. Well, for those who...
Speaking of numerology.
Yeah, speaking of, and for those who thought, man, I thought that this, the conversation before the conversations weren't serious. I thought they were goofs and gaffes and conspiracy theories abound. Nope. Sometimes, sometimes we want to have...
Speaking of goofs and gaffes.
Speaking of goofs and gaffes.
We're talking to a guy
today. We are. And his name is Mike Smith. And...
he never makes goofs and gaffes.
No, he's... You guys are going to have some goofs and gaffes as you go through his story, because we believe that everyone has a story, and you guys are going to get into his right now. Let's go.
Here with Mike Smith. Is it Michael?
It is Michael.
Michael, what's the middle name?
Purnell.
Purnell.
It is.
Is that a family name?
It is. Purnell. I was named after my uncle. A little ethnic juice for you.
Michael Purnell.
Smith.
Smith.
Yeah.
From okay, where is home?
For me or for my parents?
Well, for sure. Let's start with your parents.
South. Well, Alabama, Georgia.
Okay.
Whitesville.
Whitesville, Alabama.
Yep, little areas down there.
Did you ever live there?
I did not. No.
No.
They came up it was one of those deals where aunt for my mom, great aunt or aunt for my dad, moved up to the Chicagoland area, and then family progressively.
Why did they move up to the Chicagoland area?
This is where work was and opportunity. Okay. It was pretty much the story was told, the farm down south.
Okay.
And opportunity both for both of them were up here, and that's where the family transitioned. So,
oh, wow.
I've only known
Chicagoland.
Chicagoland.
So when you say Chicagoland, that's usually a bit of a giveaway to me now, that the people who say that are like, I've lived in the suburbs most of my life.
Correct. And I've heard this debate, and my wife enforces the understanding that you have, as she is from Detroit, and she takes to heart those who say they're from Detroit, and
then those who say they're from Detroit,
and they're from, yes, the outskirts.
Okay.
She would say, you did not grow up in Detroit. You didn't have the experience I had, so you don't get to claim it.
Okay.
So
that's a little elitist.
A little bit.
But it's okay. I understand. Listen, I understand. Yeah. But as somebody who's grown up in I grew up in the suburbs, but I've lived in the city in some places, and I've lived in the suburbs and in the very rural now, sure, and ex-urban sort of stuff. So
second largest city in Illinois, but not Chicago.
Yes, you live. So Aurora, though, is where you're.
The City of Lights.
Did you guys move there when you first came up here? Was it Aurora?
No. So my family is from, or my mom's family is from the Wheaton area. My dad was out of Chicago. When the two of them got married, they settled in Carroll Stream. And when they had purchased a home, when I was one, they built a house in Aurora, and they still are there to this day.
Wow.
So I've only known Aurora, pretty much.
What's great about Aurora? I'm not asking that in a sarcastic fashion. I have been to Aurora. I actually like it. But sure. What if there's somebody around who's not like, Aurora, but like, how would you sell Aurora to us?
How I would sell Aurora? It's a community that is diverse. It is a community that's proud. Not in a vainful way or look at me, but it's one of those, if you live there, if you know Aurora, you get it. Not to be elitist. That's not what I'm saying. But Aurora is one where you have those who are scratching two pennies together, living with those who are multimillionaires. But at the same time, there's a sense of community because we claim Aurora. Now, there's a west side and east side, so there's a rivalry amongst.
So what's the difference between the west and the east? Describe people from East Aurora.
It's a lot of the same, to be honest with you.
You're trying to be diplomatic.
I certainly am. But it's a lot of the same. The West Aurora Blackhawks, East Aurora Tomcats.
Okay.
Some of it goes back to the schooling systems. There's an idea that,
but there's no, is there a big socioeconomic difference or like a racial difference? Are there more African Americans in one place or more Hispanic or
more Hispanic on the east side?
Okay.
So there is a demographic difference,
yeah,
to a degree, but both east and west are very diverse.
Yeah.
But if you go far east side, you're tipping close to Naperville. So,
which is a little higher,
higher
rent
and higher level socioeconomic status at that point. But Aurora is just it's a wonderful community.
But you live in West Aurora.
I live in Sugar Grove.
Oh, that's even better.
The secret's out. But I claim Aurora because that's where I work.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I didn't even know where Sugar Grove is.
It's Aurora adjacent.
Okay.
It's a little village of Sugar Grove.
Okay.
Yes.
But you like Sugar Grove.
I love where I live, and I like Sugar Grove.
Okay. Yes. It's kind of a fun name to a town, though, right? It feels like that should be in some, that's the name of a town in some movie somewhere.
So that's part of, as I was thinking about the answer to your question, if you drive around Aurora, you have what feels like industry, but then you could drive 10 minutes and you're looking at cornfields.
Yes, that's true.
So just the juxtaposition of all of that together, it's just neat to me.
Unique. And it kind of is the edge of Chicagoland, though, right?
Yes.
Because it used to be, okay, so I live in Barrington, right next to 59.
Sure.
And 59, that road, people told me, what used to be the historic, edge of Chicago. But by no means is it now Chicagoland. It by no means is it considered that at all. And it feels for me that that's kind of become Randall Road, maybe even further toward 47 or so.
Correct. I think the connection to Chicago for Aurora would be the Chicago Premium Outlets. So it goes back to shopping. You tell people, I live in Aurora. Where's that? Chicago. That's in the cornfields. Well, it's by the Chicago Premium. I know where that is.
I've been there.
Yes. But all good.
It is all good. So you grew up there.
I did.
And what kinds of stuff did you do growing up? Was your family into certain things? Did your parents teach you particular stuff that's unique to your family?
That's an interesting question. It's not like we were tradesmen. That's not my dad's bag. So I'm good at calling someone, if that's what you're asking. But in terms of what did we do growing up, aside from church, my brother and I went to Aurora Christian, and we both played basketball, and we both played soccer. So that's what we did.
Sports.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So which were you better at, basketball or soccer?
Well, because I am vertically challenged, I focused my efforts in soccer. Right. Although there was a ceiling, quote, figuratively and literally, on my basketball career. Although I did play at Judson, NAIA, I was better, if I'm answering your question, at soccer.
Okay.
Yeah. Right defensive back.
Right defensive back.
Yes. And what's I played defense because my brother was a forward, and it was the opportunity for us to go head-to-head.
Okay.
And our high school coach would say the only time he had to break up a fight was...
How much older than you is he?
He is 3 years.
3 years older. Yeah. So, like, you were little
he
brother.
He was a senior. I was a freshman. I made varsity. He had made varsity as a freshman as well, but I made varsity as a freshman, and as a senior, he wasn't going to let a freshman take him, and as a freshman, I was going to take out a senior.
So, yeah.
Yes. Thankfully, we were on the same team, but actually, it was kind of funny because teams would get confused because we do favor one another. So they would get past him and I would show up. So, you know, but big brother looked out for me at the same time.
Oh, well, that's nice.
All good.
As a right back, and for those of you who aren't acquainted with with football, the real football,
football,
the right back, usually a defense in soccer has four defenders. Mm-hmm. There's the two central defenders. And then they have guys who are out on the wings, the backs, fullbacks. Mm-hmm. And the right-hand side is one where your back's to your own goal and you look forward. And so he would be on that right-hand side. Usually the guys who run forever because they have to kind of support the offense a little bit and run like crazy back because they're responsible defensively. And also kind of have a nasty streak because a lot of times the winger, which is usually one of the fastest guys on the field for the other team, is trying their best to run straight down the line past the defender. Correct. So when that happens, the right or left back has a choice to make, and that is, if I can't get the ball, I absolutely am taking the man. But you can't make it look too obvious or get kicked out of the game.
Taken in love.
So it's a... I mean, if you know a right or left back, they're usually kind of jerks out on the field. It was that true of you?
And we're done. Yeah. That's my story.
Yeah, the guys who come off the field afterwards and you're like, I hate that guy. He's ridiculous.
Yes. My focus was to decimate any dreams of glory for a forward that I was assigned to. Yes. And my tactics were well within the boundaries, but...
Yeah, the dark.
I figured out where the outskirts of the boundaries were.
That's right.
Stayed close to those.
Yeah. So in soccer, there's a thing they call the dark arts. and that's basically where you mess around with the other player and things that are not, they don't have a whole lot to do with the game, right? So like if you take the guy down, you push the ball away so he has to go walk for it, or you might stand in front of the ball so he can't take a quick free kick, or you might stand on his shoelace for a while, or, you know, if he bumps you, follow. Like, there's a whole bunch of little things you can do. You can tug him and push him because there's only one referee really on the ground most of the time. And so you can do that. So, Mike, I'm learning things about you by the fact that you took to this particular position.
Right, and I appreciate your understanding.
Feisty.
I may or may not have done the things that you just
so described. Are you a feisty guy when you were growing up as little brother or
no? Well, how would you describe feisty?
I don't know.
You
weren't a pushover.
So let me how I was growing up, and I've said this before when people have asked. My mom said I should be a lawyer because that was a reflection of my desire to share my opinion. Okay. So my feistiness was not my brother and I, Eddie, we're not fighting all the time. But I wasn't shy about sharing my perspective and my opinion. And I would push that agenda as much as possible, respectfully.
Yeah. Did you want to be a lawyer ever?
No, I always wanted to be in education. Yes.
When did you come to the conclusion that or the first thought in your mind that I would really like to either teach or be involved in some kind of school?
Fifth grade. I had a
phenomenal, something happen?
No. I had a phenomenal fifth grade teacher. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the year, I would come home and my parents could see it. I had fun. And even as a 10-year-old, I connected that I learned something too. So there was a part of me that wanted to do that for other people. So it's a direct connection to the teacher I had. And yeah. I had some pretty cool coaches. So in my mind, I was going to teach and coach.
Yeah.
But as I got older, that was refined. But I definitely knew I wanted to be a teacher.
Yeah. You've taught. I have kind of a challenging question for you. You don't need to. You can be your diplomatic if you want. There's always been a bit of a debate among Christian people. A little bit about like, where do I send my kids to school? So there's mm-hmm. the homeschool kind of option. Mm-hmm. There's the Christian school and then there's public school. And there's arguments that some people have for all three of them. You've mm-hmm. actually been involved in two of those, mm-hmm. both public and Christian school. Mm-hmm. You are currently actually the superintendent of a public school district, mm-hmm. West Aurora. But you grew up in a Christian school. Mm-hmm. Have you ever taught in one?
No.
But you have experience in both these things. So tell me, you must obviously advocate for kids being involved in public school, but
sure.
But would you advise if somebody came to you and said, look, Mike, you're an educator, you've been involved in all this stuff. Tell me the pros and cons.
Sure. That's as I process that question, to answer your question, what you've described, I went to Aurora Christian. I went to Aurora Christian from pre-K all the way through graduation. That was my parents' choice, but at the same time, I distinctly remember my father asking me as I was going into my freshman year of high school, hey, do you want to keep going to Aurora Christian or did you want to transfer? I said, no, I wanted to stay. That had an impact on me that I didn't understand until I got older. So if I was answering that question, I would answer it the way I would share with the person I was talking to the conversation I had with my wife, Olivia, which is we believe that, especially for us, the public school in terms of our decision to step into education does not reflect or have reflected amongst the staff individuals that reflect the populations that they're serving. So we saw it as an opportunity for us professionally to step into that space and have an impact and be a model to those that we were teaching. Now, if I was making the decision for my children, of which I have three daughters, this is the part I was getting to. The answer to that is we will do what is best for our children. Mm-hmm. We believe in public education, which is why we've enrolled our girls in public school. But we know if there is something ever, whether I'm the superintendent or not, if there is something that we see that is providing a negative impact or negatively impacting one of our daughters, and we felt the decision would be needed to be made to transfer her, homeschool, private school, we have no problem doing that. What I know is, when I was coming up, there was a challenge with the private school and public school and the quality of the education. Mm. I didn't know the public school then, but I also knew the quality of a biblically based education, which I will not deny anyone if that's what they feel is best for their child. But what I do know is, there is a quality and depth of education that is being provided via the public school that at times outpaces what's happening in the private school. There are just opportunities that students can have via that experience that they won't have in the private school. Right. But if a parent, mom, dad, whoever, feels though that they want their child to go through and have an education via a biblical perspective. I'm not going to fault that, but I also know because of the decision that we made, my wife and I are responsible to provide that filter for our girls. And really, it's provided some pretty rich conversations when we've come home because they are processing things. And it goes back to how we've raised them, but they are processing things at a middle school and high school level that I didn't have to process, not because I went to Aurora Christian. Our world has changed, yeah. But they're bringing it home and we're processing it together because that's the world that they're living in.
Yeah. And if you have a relationship with your kids, that's pretty robust and open, the kids are going to come home and talk to you about like
100%
why is there a furry in the class, or why is there mm-hmm. somebody who's, you know, got particular background mm-hmm. and they're not sure what to make of that mm-hmm. In the class. And that is one of the benefits of public education, is that you get they have not only exposure, but exposure in a context where you're able to kind of disciple them mm-hmm. through all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. The challenge that comes is, you know, the typical, hey, my kid went through Christian school and then they went off to Iowa State. Mm-hmm. And their roommate or the people who live next door, you know, one of them is a furry or something like that. And now all they're doing is figuring that out with their friends,
sure.
who are not probably the best, you know, leaders in the thinking about it.
Sure.
And this is something that public school kids really do have over.
And I'm not going to sit here and say one's better than the other. That's why I started this. It's a decision that is made what's best for the family,
yeah.
for your kids. And where I'm challenged is those, if you don't choose this, you're wrong.
Yeah, theologically or biblically, this is an area of Christian freedom. I wish the church would really embrace that. There are really positive reasons for you to, and honestly, if I sat down with somebody who's committed to homeschooling, there's positive reasons to homeschool your kid, there's positive reasons to put them in a Christian school. Mm-hmm. There's really positive reasons to put them in a public school. It really does depend on the kid. But that's what I appreciate about you, Mike, is your willingness to recognize that, look, my particular philosophies about, you know, living in the world and those kinds of things are not more important than the individual of my child. So some kids are going to be able to fit within certain, you know, my particular agendas, but other times, you know, if they're being bullied or having a difficult time with certain things or closing down to me, that it you know, a change of scenery can be really helpful, or being in a different kind of place.
Sure.
Can be really helpful.
Sure. And I will say, it's been a blessing for Olivia and I to hear the girls come home and share just a snapshot of where they were able to share their faith with a friend.
Yeah.
Not in an overt stand on a soapbox or anything like that, but their friends know that they're Christians.
Yeah.
And yet they're not lording it over their friends. Their friends are accepting, they're accepting of their friends, and they make it work.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool.
Which is the workplace of the future for them, right? I mean, that's ultimately where they're going to have to be in situations and friendships with people who might not share their particular worldview.
I went through Aurora Christian, but I failed to state that I also went to Judson.
Christian College.
Christian College. And some of those fairies, what did you call them?
Furries.
Furries.
Sorry. I'm not saying that every school's got furry. It's just, that seems to be kind of like the radical edge in the minds of a lot of people about, look what's happening in public schools. Sure. There are people who are acting like cats.
Yep.
And okay, yeah, there are maybe a handful of people who are doing that. But again, what are we going to do about it? Now, my kids go to Christian school, and there's reasons for that. Mm-hmm. But it really is a family and individual decision that's best for each kid, mm-hmm. I think.
Mm-hmm. So regardless of the environment, there is still a value we have in family dinner.
Yeah.
Because we've processed things from school, from the family, from church, but we process it as a family at family dinner. And that's how we're able to minister to our girls and to one each other.
Were your grandparents Christians as well? I mean, you grew up, I'm assuming that your parents were Christians because they were sending you to this Christian school. Was that mm-hmm. the case?
Yes.
And so
my parents very much were believers. We went to Wheaton Christian Center, a charismatic church out of Wheaton, still around today. Pastor Carlton Arthur's, who has since passed, but was very formative for my parents. But in terms of answering your question, grandparents, my grandmother, my mom's mom, talk about the matriarch. Yeah. So you hear the picture of parents are away, grandma's watching the kids. I have many a memory of walking up the stairs into the kitchen and seeing my grandma cut peas. I don't know if you know what that is. So peas, the pea pods, you break them.
Yeah.
You cut them, right? She's cutting peas in a big pot because she's making family dinner. She has a Bible open that she's reading, or she's listening to Christian music. But the defining beyond that, though, she would invite the neighborhood kids to do a mini devotional. She said, if I'm going to watch Mike and Eddie, then we're going to invite the friends over. They can come play, but we're going to do a mini devotional. So that village mindset was what was ingrained in me. So it definitely, it was in the house. I grew up in a Christian home. Mom and dad, faithful. Back in the day, service, 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 6 o'clock on Sunday, and Wednesday, midweek. Mom was in the choir. Dad was an usher. Dad served on the board. So I've grown up in the church.
Was Aurora Christian? I'm assuming it was like predominantly white.
Yes.
As an African-American boy, were you like one of the only?
There was a handful of us.
Okay.
So what you're getting to is I've lived a world of duality.
Yeah, man.
Yes. Very much. So
was your neighborhood when you grew up?
Predominantly white.
Predominantly white.
Yes. Family. Predominantly.
All right,
black,
so I have a bunch of questions now.
Please.
I want to know what unique challenges there are for a little black boy growing up in a predominantly white neighborhood.
So you say, was Aurora Christian predominantly white? Yes, it was. But I still hold true. Our family has never been more embraced by a community than the community of Aurora Christian.
Yeah.
There were stalwarts of faith that were there that helped grow my faith. But getting to answering your question, as a young man, I quickly recognized the duality of the life I was living. I don't know if you've heard the term code switching.
Yep, I do.
I did not live.
Describe what that is, though.
But code switching is talking in a manner that would not offend or make others uncomfortable. You, for lack of a better way to say it, you speak with a proper cadence and tone and without slang.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to send the picture that as soon as I walked in the door, you'd think I walked the streets because mom didn't handle that. You go to school, you have an education, you will talk as if you have an education. But there is a proverbial letting your hair down when you're around other African Americans or black students, as opposed to those that you historically are with throughout the day.
Right.
The music that's played, things that you do, So, yes.
So there, this has been a criticism of some public African Americans. When I say criticism, there are people who look on like online and they'll say this person is not consistent between this group or that group. In fact, I think this has been a criticism that's been leveled at Kamala Harris recently. Mm-hmm. So I need to tell you, as somebody who lived overseas, everybody does this kind of thing. So, cause when I would get together with other, Americans, you drop into a comfort level with them because you share a background that is not the same as you do with others. And so this is my very small comparison. It's not duplicitous. Mm-hmm. It's not I actually get a little frustrated when I hear people talk about, it's just duplicitous. This person is not the same person. Actually, they are. They're just in a situation where they know that there are certain appropriate places for them to act certain ways and certain appropriate places for them not to act.
Well, and when I'm at school, I didn't repeatedly tell the story to my friends about when I went to the mall and got followed. Because they don't have a connection to that.
No.
So I just saved that story for when I was with those who would understand and could connect.
Right, and they'd all nod and be like, let me tell you about when I...
Right. Because when they go through it or they see it happen to me, they want to... Did you see that? Or, they followed you all over. I know.
Yeah.
It's something that I'm aware of that they're experiencing for the first time. Yeah. So now the door is open for us to talk about it, yeah. but I don't come to the table because they don't, they'll listen. I had good friends. My best friends are from high school, but their connection and understanding mm-hmm. was totally different. Ah, Mike's just joining on. And in the back of my mind, okay, I'm at the table and I have to wait for those opportunities to share and give a glimpse into my perspective without coming across as my fist is always in the air.
Yeah.
And I'm not questioning or challenging those that do that. That's just not my style. And I've found success going back to the question that you asked me about the world that I, or my experience, even with work, I work around predominantly white individuals. But at the same time, I look for those opportunities to share a perspective when they're ready and can digest what it is that I'm going to share. A really close colleague of mine, I've told him, I could be offended every day if I wanted to.
Yeah.
But I choose not to approach my life like that.
Yeah.
But those opportunities, I just take them where they are.
Yeah.
And step through them. Actually, you've pushed me.
Yep.
At different times. Why didn't you? Because I'm settling into the seat at the table.
I still think you should share. but I totally understand. I understand in my mind regarding what you're yes. saying. That's not something I've had to live because of my own particular background. But so I'm going to ask you some advice.
All right, advice.
You're going to give me some advice. Well, no, here's what I want you to do. I want you to tell me what brothers in Christ, Jimmy, yes. what would you like white Christians, after being a guy who's grown up living in both those worlds, being well acquainted with kind of with white Christian culture, especially in Chicagoland, right?
Sure.
What do you wish white Christians in Chicagoland could understand about their black Christian brothers and sisters that would make unity a little bit easier or understanding a little bit easier? Are there a few things that would help?
Can I flip the question?
No.
Yes. Okay. So how would you answer that question for yourself? If you were talking to me or talking to other, how would you answer the question?
What do I wish African-American Christians would understand about white Christians? So I'm going to answer it.
Go ahead. And there's a reason why I flipped the question back on you.
Well, I actually don't mind having you ask this question of me because I do have an answer. And that's, okay. So here's my answer. I think most white Christians desperately want their African-American brothers and sisters to know that they really love them and look up to them in many ways. They're just not 100% sure how to act or think in the setting. Sometimes they find themselves in with other African-Americans. They're not sure what, they don't want to look stupid. And so they're like, and they don't want to ever sound in any way like someone could accuse them of any kind of racism.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't mean it,
mm-hmm.
but they are also products. Right? So this is why I understand you're flipping the question. They're also products of their upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
And they've grown up in predominantly, you know, white settings. And so when they meet somebody, let's take it out of the African-American, they meet somebody who's got like a Korean background or something like that. Their first thought is, oh, where are you from? And they mean it in a positive way. They're actually really interested in it. But the Korean person's like, you would never ask that of, you know, the Polish person or the other white person who just because of their skin color.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it would help if they understood the intent, although I am very happy to be corrected by the implicit assumption that I'm making, that I often make, which sure. is, hey man, you're obviously not, you know, where are you from? You look different than me, or do you know what I mean?
Sure. Sure.
Does that make sense?
I think.
No.
I think so. And the reason why I asked you the question is because I've been asked that question many times. And unfortunately, I understand your heart and I understand the heart of what you're trying to share on behalf of my white brothers and sisters.
Yep.
But when I give an answer, they now take that little clip of what I say and they broad stroke it.
Huh.
As opposed to, this is just a perspective of Mike Smith
right.
via what he's gone through,
right, and to,
versus everyone else,
and to assume that that is like the representative African American viewpoint is to be like, oh, come on, don't be so, you know, don't be so simplistic about.
But let's go back to what you said, because
I just want you to know, my view is exactly what every white person thinks.
Sure,
I'm totally, I'm kidding.
When
I am actually the representative of every white Christian.
So I actually want to come back to that.
Yeah.
Because that speaks to an answer to your question to a degree, what you just said from my perspective. But let's go back to what you asked me. What would I say? What I would say if I was talking to or having a class for those, okay, how do we do this? You started with, yes, we share a faith. That is a basis, but that's not it. So some would say, well, aren't we all Christians? Well, yes, I believe, as you do, that Christ died on the cross for my sins. And at the end of the day, with that foundation, we can build tremendous connections.
Yeah.
Right? So yes, that is a foundation, but it doesn't stop there, because now we're introducing experience and perspective. You talk about your many travels, and it piques my interest. Even though I bring a different perspective culturally, you bring a different perspective globally to a degree than my little world of Aurora, Illinois, as an example. But you also, as you were talking, and maybe it's been via your experience, as you were explaining your perspective, you shined through a level of authenticity that opened the door for me to listen to you and not be offended by one more person who hasn't seen the same thing that I've seen and I still can't figure out that at times minorities aren't treated exactly the same in this world. So there is an empathy that you articulated, even as you were giving an answer that connected us, that I wasn't like, okay, here we go.
Yeah.
Because that's what I mean. In the spaces that I live in, that's why I said I could be offended every day.
Mm-hmm.
I've let that go, because when I'm asked those questions, I see those as opportunities and doors God's opened to me to connect and share.
Yeah.
Because I can't be, there are some who would be offended to say, you don't get it yet.
Because it gets
but
old.
But I have to embrace the fact that, yeah, for some, they just haven't gotten it yet.
Yeah.
They haven't seen it yet. They haven't, but coming to me, they feel safe enough around me to where they can be exposed in terms of, I may offend, but I've heard Mike. He said I can ask him. All right, let's go.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So let's go back to what you said about you represent the white community.
I do.
So to a degree.
You still believe me?
Yeah. To a degree, that's why I said what I did about asking the question back to you. And sorry to go off on this tangent, but in, you asked me about the worlds I've lived in.
Sure.
I know that for many people, I am the, and this is not a look at me, or this is not a over-grandizing statement. Even me saying that tells you, I know that I'm going to represent what a Christian, a African-American Christian looks like to a lot of people.
Mike, so this is the sad state of affairs, is that in way too many cases, you might be someone's only black friend, Christian friend. And that,
to a degree, yeah.
And that, yeah, it's hard, because especially if you're like growing up in your situation here, you're a guy who's been willing to and been thrust by God's providence into a world full of white people. And so in some weird ways, you do represent to them a whole culture. And
correct.
Where you're like, I don't represent a whole culture. And like, cause there's so many different
100%.
Cultural backgrounds and people who do different things. Some African-Americans like certain things and some African-Americans don't like that. I mean, just like any group of people anywhere,
yes.
But you end up becoming this representation. Is that, would it be enough to say that you would just like people to recognize one of the pieces of advice you'd give people is don't recognize I'm not the only representation that you've got, that there are others.
There are other layers.
Yes.
Yes. But I also know that I also have the responsibility, because I am that to a number of folks, that I will either affirm
yeah.
or disprove their stereotype.
Yeah.
And you and I have talked about this.
Yeah. Your willingness to talk about it, though, Mike, is awesome.
Oh, thank you.
Seriously, because I actually think that when I lived in Canada, there was what we call an Indo-Canadian population in the town that I lived in. And they went, I think I might have brought this up before, Indo-Canadians, milk is way cheaper in the United States than in Canada for a number of reasons. Mm-hmm. But Indo-Canadians would come across the border, mostly from South Asia. They were people who, a lot of them from the Punjab mm-hmm. region, and they would come across the border and they would buy so much milk, like so much milk. And they come back across the border with their 12 gallons of milk. Mm-hmm. And so people usually didn't have many Indo-Canadian friends at all. They might have one or two or whatever. And so that one friend, they never felt like they could ask them, why do you guys have so much milk? Anyway, one day this is going to prove your point. One day I asked this guy who I know, I said, dude, why do you have so much milk? Like, I just want to know, you're always going to get milk. And he goes, we bathe in it. And he was so lying to me. Just,
I love that.
But I honestly, I was like, oh my gosh. So then I went, don't buy the friends who never had the courage. I said, dude, they're bathing it. Anyway, so same guy, like a few weeks later, he said, I said, oh, milk, when you bathe, we got in some conversation yeah. and I had made some joke about him bathing in milk. And he goes, dude, I don't bathe in milk. What are you talking about? I don't bathe in milk. I said, well, why do you have so much milk? We like milk.
Yep.
What are you talking about? We just like milk.
Sure.
It's safer oftentimes where people 100%. Are from because it's pasteurized and you don't drink the water. And like, come on, man. We like milk.
So to your point, a couple things.
Race, I'm such an idiot. Although I have a lot of regard for him right. for the joke.
And I have to interrogate even my own bias when I see folks. But my experience has challenged me, and really marriage has challenged me because here's an example, similar to what you talked about. My wife and I talk about experience, you know, what we dream, what we want to do, things we want to take care, things we want, how we want to take care of our girls, you know, but at the same time, we want to all of it with an open hand.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't work out, God had a plan. And she said, Mike, that thought, because we were processing a message, that thought means something different to me than you. I said, what are you talking about? We're together. We're nope. Mike, I grew up this is my wife, Olivia.
Yeah.
You grew up in Aurora. You had mom and dad with you your whole life. So your failing is failing to the safety net of what you know is a community of connection that's going to take care of you. Her loss of everything is literally nothing in the bank. We don't know where food's coming from. There's mice, rats, and I live next to a drug house. So that's what I mean. I wasn't ready. I couldn't understand it until I got to know her more via marriage and understood her story to where I could process what failing means, but
yep.
I couldn't do it when we first met.
Yeah,
but
I totally understand. No, it requires a ton of listening and a ton of mistakes. This is, the problem is the beauty of both the church and our world is that God has made us different, and culture is so fun. To be honest with you, it actually is.
100%.
I remember coming back from the first time I had ever gone overseas. It was in Europe, and mm-hmm. I came back, and I remember telling a friend of mine that they did certain things in Germany, mm-hmm. and I remember him just saying, that's so weird, and it ticked me off. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. I just was like, what do you mean? I mean, I know it's weird to you. It's different than what you're used to. I've heard that for years when I've gone to when I talk to people about how, you know, like Maori people in New Zealand will greet each other with the hangi, with the nose pressed up against each other's nose and foreheads against each other. I've had so many, that's so weird. Nah, it's not weird. It's the way that they've grown up in this. Have you ever just stopped and thought how weird it is for us to actually grab each other's hand every time? I mean, you just learn that.
Sure.
And in certain cultures, that's weird. other guys are going to dap each other up, and they don't think that's weird, but you think that's weird. Mm-hmm. But that's the beauty of culture, mm-hmm. is that you end up experiencing so many different things. If you're willing to listen, you're willing to make some mistakes.
Love that.
And when you make the mistakes, be willing. The first thing to say is, "I'm sorry."
There it is.
I did not mean to. I didn't. In no way did I mean to offend you. And 100%. Almost everybody I've ever interacted with, especially Christian brothers and sisters, their first response is like, "It's all right. We know you're not from here, or you're new here and stuff."
Sure.
But I just can't help but think the church would be great, more so much better served if there was a posture of listening, and a posture of humility that we have toward one another when it comes to cultural differences.
Sure. Sure. No, there's, and I don't know how much time we have, but as an example, real quick. So I was, went away to college, came back, some buddies of mine went to the movies. I was driving. So we got out of the movie late. It was in the middle of winter because we were home for winter break. Late, I was going to leave. All right, look in the rearview mirror, lights start flashing. Okay. I know the routine, so I'm preparing, got my license, registration, all good. Now, for those listening, what I would describe is, as I looked in the rearview mirror, or to my side mirror, the police officer was walking up to my side passenger's, or mm-hmm. the driver's side door, but he was turned, and it looked like his hand was by his gun. So I was like, okay, hey, at that point, my job is to de-escalate. If I did something wrong, yes, sir. Help me understand. The reason why he pulled me was the light over my license was out. Mm. I believe that's what he told me. So, but as he looked inside the car, I had two of my buddies with me. He's like, I want licenses of everybody in the car. My buddies were white. My buddy in the front seat, why is he taking my license? I didn't do anything wrong. Can you just please give him your license? Just, it's okay. So my front seat buddy, absolutely upset. Cop comes back. Hey, your light was out. I'm going to let you go. Just make sure you take a look at it. When I got home, the light worked. But here nor there, here's the key. And this is why I'm telling this story. When he drove away, I kind of had to collect myself. My buddy was fired up. He was hot. Mm-hmm. It's like, hey, this is how it goes. But you were fine. He's like, he didn't need my license. It's okay. It's all good. I turn around. My other buddy was in the back seat because it was cold, he had a full ski mask on. So we actually turned into, it was a good laugh. And I immediately, speaking of being willing to listen, my heart went to empathize with the police officer. Mm. So black guy driving, guy with the ski mask in the back seat, and a white guy's in the front. So I can laugh about it now. But in that moment.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but the crazy thing is, in every situation that we walk in, we come with a set of presuppositions that are formed almost entirely by our cultural background.
Yep.
And understanding those helps us go a long way to being able to live well with each other. Mm-hmm. And
but it does.
I'm actually thankful though that I get to live with you. You're a good dude.
Appreciate
Mike.
That.
I always appreciate it. Mike was actually on the elder board when I first got here, and he was a godsend. On the edge, not that the elder was better. I just, it was, you were a godsend to have here. It was really great to see you for serving so faithful. And I actually want to tell you, thank you for being willing to step forward in the moment of crisis for the church and being willing to serve faithfully in that kind of, you guys took lots and lots of hits and leadership's hard.
Some phenomenal brothers that I sat at the table with and just humbled that I had the opportunity to sit with him.
We're going to come back at some time. Next time I want to know how you got married.
Oh, sorry.
How you met her.
Okay.
And I also want to know how you became, the superintendent of West Aurora School District and, what that's like.
Okay.
Seriously, we're going to have part two with Mike at some point. So God bless you, brother. Thanks so much for being here with me.
I appreciate having me.
The rest of you. We'll talk to you next time.